Tonight we come to the next study in our one book series, and that is the book of Zephaniah. It is on page number 1358. At least that's the page in my Bible. It may be different in yours, and it probably is. It's stuck right there between two H books, Habakkuk and Haggai. If you're scanning through the minor prophets, you see one of those, you're getting real close. The book of Zephaniah. It has been said that Zephaniah is the least known book in the Bible. And I don't know if that's true or not. It's just one person's opinion. But if it is so that the book of Zephaniah is the least known book in the Bible, I imagine it is probably because of its subject matter. For you see, Zephaniah deals with possibly the most uncomfortable topic in the whole Word of God, and that is the topic of judgment. We live in a time when most people would rather be guilty of anything, any sin, than to be guilty of being judgmental. I mean, all of us have heard that. You know, maybe we've made a statement about something that we feel passionate about. Perhaps we even cited or quoted the Word of God in that, and that's the way it should be. If we're very passionate about something, we should have God's Word backing us up. And then someone says, well, you're judgmental. You're just judgmental. Everybody knows it says in Matthew 7 in verse 1, judge not that you be not judged. Everybody knows that that verse is in the Bible, but they don't know John 7, 24 says, don't judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Most people don't know that verse is in the Bible. So, you know, one of the worst things you can be guilty of today is the sin of judging people or being judgmental. But the book of Zephaniah shines a light on how God is judgmental. God is a God of judgment. And I imagine some people don't like this book because it focuses on judgment. But you know what? If that is the case, those same people that may not like this book because they think it's all about God's judgment, they also miss something that's very beautiful. They miss the reason that God is a God of judgment. And I'll talk about that here in just a moment. Before we jump into the text, though, let's just lay out a few things about the book of Zephaniah. If you look at the very first verse of this book, chapter 1 and verse 1, it documents how Zephaniah could trace his genealogy back four generations, all the way back to King Hezekiah, who lived about 100 years before him. And that is pretty fascinating that this prophet, Zephaniah, could say, I was kin to King Hezekiah. This has led some to refer to him as the royal prophet. This also shows Zephaniah's connection to the royal family, and it also makes sense that he's connected to Josiah, the current king of Judah, when this book is being written or when this prophecy is being prophesied. This also explains why Zephaniah had such a comprehensive knowledge of the city of Jerusalem. That's most likely where he lived. And if you look in chapter 1, verses 10 and 11, you can see how he makes some pretty specific references to things about the city of Jerusalem that only a person that lived there would even know. And so likely he lived there. Also, this connection helped him know Jerusalem and know Israel's kings, but it also gave him a front row seat to what was wrong in Israel, specifically Judah. This is a prophecy to the southern tribe, to Judah. He had a front row seat for Israel's problems and the sins she was guilty of, and he vividly documents that in this book. And also, there's another connection here with him being connected to the kings. The connection to Josiah, I think, is very interesting because it's very likely that Zephaniah's prophecy would have been very pivotal in a thing that happened under the kingship of Josiah. And that is, there was this great reform that started to take place. And it could be that it was a part of Zephaniah prophesying about how we've got to get our act together. And there's this great reform that takes place under King Josiah. It's estimated that that happened around the year 621 B.C. King Josiah ruled Judah from 640 to 609 B.C. You remember, he was a good king. And he was one who led that restoration of the people when they found the book of the law. You can read about that, of course, in 2 Chronicles 34 and 35. But that was very short-lived, unfortunately. The reforms, getting back to the Word of God, it did not last as long as it should have lasted. It was short-lived, and the nation soon apostatized shortly after his death. And another thing about the connection to Zephaniah and to the kings, I think this shows us three men, Josiah, Jeremiah, and Zephaniah, who it is estimated were all in their 20s about the time that they were going about doing their prophetic work, and of course Josiah being the king of Judah. Men in their 20s. I wanted to say that especially for our young people and for anybody else here that sometimes thinks that young people can't be influenceable and young people can't, you know, have an impact on other people or they can't lead older people. Young people have a lot of influence. And these three had tremendous influence on the history of God's people in the Old Testament. And also this about Zephaniah as well. Zephaniah's preaching was sharp, and it is straightforward, so much that he has sometimes been referred to as the Puritan prophet. He would have been considered a hellfire and brimstone preacher in his day. So much that one writer, George Smith, said that no hotter book lies in all of the Old Testament than the book of Zephaniah. And remember, it's probably because of the subject matter at hand. So let's turn to that. Let's look at the text for a little bit tonight. It's a short, very short book, only three chapters. I think if I figured it up right, about 58 verses or so. Very short, very compact. And there are really two things. If you really want to know what's in the book of Zephaniah, you need to know two things. Here's the first thing. You need to know it's about the judgment of God. I've already made reference to that. And the majority of this book is about God's judgment on sin. Remember, Zephaniah's lot was to preach on what most people consider to be the most unpleasant topic of all, and that is God's judgment. The expression, the day of the Lord, it's used very frequently in this book, probably depending on your translation. My translation, the expression is the day of the Lord. And that expression, that phrase is used to refer to the sweeping, powerful judgment of God. This is the reference point. When the day of the Lord occurs, this is when the judgment's going to happen. This is the judgment that God will do. And if you just look in chapters 1 and 2, I took a red pen and I underlined every time I saw this phrase, the day of the Lord. In my Bible, in my translation, it appears in chapter 1 and verse 7. It appears in chapter 1 and verse 8. It appears two times in chapter 1, verse 14. Then in chapter 1 and verse 18, in chapter 2, verse 2, and in chapter 2, verse 3. God's judgment is also referred to in this book at least 12 other times with the word day being used. So the judgment of the Lord would be just referred to with the word day. And with a blue pen, I underlined the times that occurs, and it's 12 times. And most of those are in chapter 1 and 2 as well. If you add that up, that's 19 times that the judgment of God on sin is referenced in this very short book. 58 chapters, 19 times. That's roughly one time in every three verses. That is why this book is known to be a book about the judgment of God. And so let's look at some examples of that. In Zephaniah chapter 1, the judgment of God is described in such fashion that even the earth itself, the land, the ground, if you will, the planet will see the judgment of God. It will have impacted on it the judgment of God. Look at verses 2 and 3. I will utterly consume everything. My footnotes there says, this will be a complete end of. It will be total destruction, in other words. I will utterly consume everything from the face of the land, says the Lord. I will consume man and beast. I will consume the birds of the heavens, the fish of the sea, and the stumbling blocks or the idols along with the wicked. I will cut off man from the face of the land or the ground, says the Lord. The point here is this judgment is so sure, it is so sweeping, it is so powerful, it is so exacting that it will impact every body and everything. That's how powerful the judgment of the Lord is said to be in the book of Zephaniah. But Zephaniah also specifically singles out Judah. Remember, this is the main audience of this book. He singles out Judah, and in verses 4 through 6, he really lays down the law, if you will, some of the things that they were guilty of. Let's look at those verses. He says in verse 4, I will stretch out my hand against Judah and against all of the inhabitants of Jerusalem. I will cut off every trace of Baal in this place. The names of the idolatrous priest with the pagan priest, those who worship with the host of heaven on the housetops, those who worship and swear oaths by the Lord, but who also swear by Milcom. And the footnote there says that this was probably an Ammonite god. It might be called Malcom. It might even be a reference to the god Molech. He says in verse 6, those who have turned back from following the Lord and have not sought the Lord nor inquired of him. He is laying bare the sins of the people. And I made a list of these things. These were people that had worshipped Baal. These were people that worshipped the heavenly bodies. These were people who mixed worship with God and foreign gods. Syncretism is the technical word for that. And that's a lesson for us to know that we can sometimes look like we're doing what God wants us to do in worship, but we can throw in other things, other worldly things that might be idolatrous in nature, and all of a sudden we're blending what we want in worship with what God wants in worship, and here these people were guilty of that as well. These people had turned away from following God, chapter 1, verse 6. They had just turned away from him. And then in the latter part of verse 6, it says they did not seek God. And then in the rest of chapter 1, Zephaniah highlights more sins and more sinners, and he explains that no sin will be overlooked. This is another thing about the judgment of God. You can't hide from it. And there's some striking verses about this. Look at verse 12. He says, it shall come to pass at that time. He's talking about, and that's, by the way, that's another reference to judgment, that time. It will come to pass at that time or that day, in the day of the Lord, that I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I'll punish the men who are settled in complacency, who say in their heart, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do evil. Nobody can escape this. It's the idea that the light is going to be shown upon those who are sinning. And the note here is about those who are settled in complacency. And by the way, he says, these people say in their heart, the Lord will do no good, or nor will he do evil. And I've read where there are at least three times in the book of Zephaniah that Zephaniah highlights a lie that the people tell about God. And here's one of them. He tells this lie about God. He's basically saying God, you know, the people think that God's out there and he doesn't really care. But Zephaniah says the judgment of God is such that he will shine a light on Jerusalem with lamps. Look at verse 15. Here is another example of the day being used. That day, he's talking about the day of judgment, remember. That day is a day of wrath, a day of trouble and distress, a day of devastation and desolation, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Oh, how powerful that is about the judgment of God. That's how those who will be judged by God, who are guilty of their sin, will feel about the day of judgment. And then look at verse 18. We need to hear this one for sure. Neither their silver nor their gold shall be able to deliver them in the day of the Lord's wrath. The whole land shall be devoured by the fire of his jealousy, for he will make speedy riddance of all those who dwell in the land. And so you've got all these powerful verses about God's judgment that applied to them, but we need to remember would apply to us as well, because we know that we will stand before God and be judged as well. And then in chapter 2, verses 14 through 15, Zephaniah also prophesies about the surrounding nations. So he's mainly talking to Judah, but then he does this in some of the other minor prophets as well, and some of the other major prophets. He will turn his attention to the sinful nations who might hear of this prophecy. And in verses 4 through 15, I find it so interesting, as he turns to these other nations, he says, "My judgment is going to go out to those in every direction, to the Philistines to the west," chapter 2, verses 4 through 7, "to the Moabites and the Ammonites to the east," chapter 2, verses 8 through 11, "to the Ethiopians to the south," chapter 2, 12, "and then to the Assyrians to the north," chapter 2, 13 through 15, "to the north and to the south, to the east and to the west, my judgment will go out to those nations." But then he comes back to his main audience. The main prophetic judgment of Zephaniah comes back squarely on God's people, Judah, the ones who should have known better, and that is the result of chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. So I told you that the book of Zephaniah is about two things. We've dealt with the hard thing, and this is the main thing that the book deals with, and that is God's judgment. But there's one other thing that this book deals with, and this is the rewarding part of our study. This book also deals with God's love and restoration to those who are penitent. Toward the end of this book, here in chapter 3, there is this beautiful transition that begins to take place. Now, before we get to that, we need to note something that's in the middle of this proclamation of judgment that's in chapter 2, and I want to read verses 1 through 3, because here in the middle of God saying, "I'm going to judge you," he gives this appeal for them to know that they can come back to him. That's what we call repentance, right? When people are sinning and they realize they can turn back to God. So notice what it says here in chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. "Gather yourselves together." Yes, gather together, "O undesirable nation, before the decree is issued." In other words, before the judgment happens. "Or that the day passes like chaff. Before the Lord's fierce anger comes upon you. Before the day of the Lord's anger comes upon you. Seek the Lord, all you meek in the earth, who have upheld his justice. Seek righteousness, seek humility. It may be that you will be hidden in the day of the Lord's anger." Here is an invitation, if you will, to those who were guilty of this sin that God's judgment was going to be poured out upon. He said, "But I want you to know, before it happens, I give you this opportunity to come back to me." And so there's the hope that's in this book. And it's a beautiful picture. 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9 says, "The Lord is not slack," or "he is not slow concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but he is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." And here is an example in the middle of God preaching, "I'm going to judge you. I am going to destroy the sin and the works of the devil from this earth." He stops in the middle of that and he says, "But I haven't done it yet, and you still have a chance. You still have the opportunity to come back to me." And then when we get to chapter 3 and verse 8, here is where we find what I would call the hidden jewel of God's judgment. It's the thing that most people don't understand about God's judgment. They don't know why God will judge. And I want you to notice, here is a beautiful statement in verse 8 of chapter 3, where God says, "Therefore, wait for me. Wait for me, says the Lord, until the day that I rise up for plunder. My determination is to gather the nations to my assembly of kingdoms, to pour on them my indignation, all my fierce anger. All the earth shall be devoured when the fire of my jealousy." He says to his people, the people who have heard the invitation to repent, who have turned back to him, who are being faithful to him, he says, be patient. Wait for me. This is one of the great features of another prophet, the prophet Isaiah. You probably recall where maybe your favorite book in the favorite verse in the whole book of Isaiah might be, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 31. Chapter 49 verse 23 says, they that wait for me shall not be put to shame. And chapter 64 and verse 4 of Isaiah says, for since the beginning of the world, men have not heard nor perceived by the ear, nor has the eye seen any God besides you who acts for the one who waits for him. So you've got this beautiful imagery in Isaiah and also here in Zephaniah. Wait on me. I will do what I've told you I will do. Yes, I will judge sin, but I also will remember you. And I will restore you. That's what this section is all about. God's love and his restoration. And then look at verse 9. Here is why God has to judge. Verse 9. For then, after judgment, for then I will restore the people a pure language, that they may call on the name of the Lord to serve him with one accord. The reason that God judges is because it purifies the earth. It purifies people. The promise that he is a just God, it purifies those who are willing to believe and to repent and to be faithful to him. John T. Carson observes from this point forward, talking about chapter 3 and verse 9, from this point forward, there is a new note of victory in Zephaniah. You might say Zephaniah switches from speaking about judgment. We would say, because we know what this is about, he's speaking about Jesus. He switches from judgment to Jesus. And so here's that hidden jewel. God's judgment is not meant to destroy, but it's meant to purify the people. And so this will be the result of that. Beginning in verse 9 and going all the way through the end of the chapter, we won't take the time to read all these verses, but he basically says, here will be the result of my judgment and my purification. It will leave you being a worshiping people, verses 9 and 10. He even says that there will be a pure language, and that's an interesting phrase because it's probably not that they would speak better or more affluent Hebrew, but that their hearts and their lives would be conformed to the will of God. And this is probably a reference to how they will be redeemed in Christ and they will be part of the new creation, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. It may also be a reference to the reversal of the confusion of languages at the Tower of Babel. This is what I'll do for you. I will leave you to be a worshiping people. I will leave you with no shame. Verse 11, in that day you shall not be shamed for any of your deeds. I will leave you as people who are meek and trusting, verse 12. I will leave you righteous and confident, verse 13. I will leave you victoriously, and you'll have salvation, verses 16 and 17. Notice those verses. In that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, Zion, let not your hands be weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, the mighty one will save. He is mighty to save. We sing that song. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. He will leave you with salvation. He will leave a place for the outcast, verses 18 and 19, and ultimately he will restore, verse 20. This is about the love and the restoration that God will give to those who turn back to him. I don't know if you noted in some of these verses that we read, I'd like to read a couple of these as we close, verses 18, 19, and 20. Listen to how the prophet Zephaniah says that God says, I will do this. Or sometimes he says, he will. Notice this in verses 18, 19, and 20. I will gather those who sorrow over the appointed assembly, who are among you, to whom is reproach, to whom its reproach is a burden. Behold, at that time, I will deal with all who afflict you. I will save the lame and gather those who are driven out. I will appoint them for praise and fame. Now remember, up in verse 11, he says, you'll not be shamed. And here he says, you'll have fame and praise. I will appoint for them praise and fame in every land where they were put to shame. At that time, I will bring you back, even at the time I gather you. For I will give you fame and praise among all the people of the earth when I return your captives before your eyes, says the Lord. All of these allusions point to the blessings of the kingdom of God that is coming. These people are hearing this for the first time, and they're thinking about a kingdom that is coming. And I would say to you that I think that this has reference to something that we are a part of right now and something that we will be a part of in the future. Right now, we are a part of these illusions in the church, the kingdom that is now the church, but also we will be a part of these blessings in the kingdom of heaven. How should we understand this? We should understand this, these promises, as being fulfilled already, but not yet. I think that's a good way of looking at it. These blessings are realized in the church. To those who have come to Jesus, to those who have fallen down at his feet and vowed allegiance to him and have been brought into his kingdom through salvation, through his blood, through obeying the gospel, we already have these blessings. These are ours. But not yet, in the sense of they're realized right now, but not to their fullest just yet. They are true, but they're not perfectly true the way they will be when we will experience these in the life to come. So, the book of Zephaniah, it's about the judgment of God on sin. It's about the love of God and the restoration of God to his people who turn back to him. That's what this book, this little book, is all about. Let me give you five lessons to remember. I'll just read these off. Number one, God is a God of goodness and severity. That's what the New Testament says, Romans 11 and verse 22. Number two, God's judgment on sin will be terrible. Number three, everybody will stand before God's judgment throne, and nothing can excuse you, even if you're rich. Number four, those who accuse and scoff and persecute God's judgment or God's righteous will have to answer for those sins. Number five, victory is the ultimate end for the penitent and the faithful. And I'll give you one bonus. Number six, if God says he's going to do something, he will do it. Remember all those expressions? I will, I will, I will. If God says he is going to do something, he will do it. We know that there will be judgment in our future. It's appointed to man once to die, and then after that, the judgment. I hope you're going to be ready for that. The way to be ready for that is through nothing that you can do for yourself, no meritorious good that you could do. You could do all the good in the world, and you can never do enough to be in favor of God unless you're in Jesus. That's how you get in favor with God. You come to his son Jesus, you believe in him, you give your life to him, and then you're covered with Jesus. And that's how you're going to be prepared to stand before God in judgment. And if you're not prepared for that, everything's ready. We're going to sing this song. We'd invite you to come and take advantage of the opportunity to come to Jesus right now as we stand. Steve.